Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. Welcome to yet another interesting video of Engineering Mathematics. This is Engineering Mathematics Lecture 3. Hopefully you are all doing great and revise the concepts which I covered in the last two lectures. If you haven't gone through them, I would request you to go through them first and then hop on to this particular video. I am a course instructor, Utkarsh Upadhyay. Please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. We will definitely get back to you with the solutions. Or if required, we can make the separate video on those doubts. Okay. In the last lecture, we basically terminated our discussion with some properties related to the matrices. And in this lecture, we are starting off with some more properties related to the matrices. Let's have a look at that, The first one is basically the inverse of a matrix. Let me use a red maroon marker so as to make it more legible and credible. So the inverse of a matrix. Inverse of a matrix for any square matrix is defined for any square matrix A for any square matrix A of order n, and should be a non-singular for any square matrix A which is non-singular, which means a determinant of that matrix should not be equal to 0. The A inverse is defined as 1 by determinant of A into adjoint of A. Okay, A inverse is defined as 1 by determinant of A into adjoint of A. So A inverse exists when it is unique. So A inverse exists when it is unique. Okay, so there are some properties of inverse of a matrix. First is that A inverse should be is equal to A inverse A is equal to identity matrix. Okay, so there are two matrices A and B. A and B are inverse of each other. A and B are inverse of each other if and only if AB is equal to BA is equal to I. That's basically, this property is basically similar to this property, the first property. Okay, let's say B is equal to A inverse, then this equation will basically boil down to the first equation. Okay, third one is that AB inverse, just like the transpose of a matrix is distributive over the product with the swapping of the positions of A and B, this inverse of the product of the two matrices is distributive, as well as it results into the multiplication of B and A with the positions swapped. So this will be equal to B inverse A inverse. Okay, this is similar to the transpose of a matrix. This is how you can remember. For example, let's say we have three matrices. This will be equal to C inverse, B inverse, A inverse. But just to remind you once again, the order, there should not be any order mismatch between the matrices. Okay, then only the product will exist. If A is n cross n non-singular matrix, if A is a non-singular matrix, then A transpose inverse is equal to A inverse transpose. So the inverse and transpose can interchange their positions. There is no harm in that. It will not change the answer. Okay, if A is n cross n non-singular matrix, then A inverse conjugate transpose should be equal to A conjugate transpose inverse. Okay, they are also basically interchange their positions. So let's say we have a matrix A, B, C, D. The direct formula that you can remember is equal to 1 by determinant of A, AD minus BC multiplied with D A minus C minus B. Okay, this is basically the direct formula that you can use for a 2 by 2 square matrix. Okay, let me just take an example of a 3 cross 3 matrix and solve it with a shortcut method. There's a trick, so shortcut method. Okay, shortcut method. For example, we take a matrix, let's say 1, 2, 1, minus 1, 3, 2, 0, 0, 4. Okay, let's say this is a matrix. We need to find out the A inverse. Let's say this is the matrix A, and then what is A inverse? Okay, so A inverse, so the shortcut method is, first of all, you write all the elements down in the same fashion, then repeat these two columns, 1, minus 1, 0, 2, 3, 0. Okay, then repeat these two rows, 1, 2, 1, 1, 2, minus 1, 3, 2, minus 1, 3. Draw a margin here, and now let's do the math. So the A inverse will be equal to, first of all, you need to find the determinant. I am not finding out the determinant. Determinant of A is quite simple to find. Okay, we need to find out the adjoint of a matrix. We need to find out the adjoint of a matrix. So just take this, just consider this particular block, 12. So answer will be 12. Okay, 3 4s are 12 minus 0. Okay, then consider this block, it will be equal to 0 plus 4. This you are not supposed to write in along the rows. Okay, you are not required to write the elements required to answer, write the answers in the, you are not supposed to write the answers in a row. Okay, you have to write them in the column. Okay, so in the in this vertical fashion, you have to write the answers in the vertical fashion. So answer will be equal to 0 plus 4. This will be equal to 4. Okay, now if you consider this particular block, it will be 0 minus 0. So answer will be 0 here. Now consider this particular block, it will be equal to 0 minus 8. So answer will be minus 8. If you consider this particular block, it will be 4 minus 0. It will be equal to 4. Okay, if you consider this block, 0 minus 0, answer will be 0. If you consider this particular block, it will be equal to 4 minus 4 minus 3. 4 minus 3 is 1. If you consider this particular block, it will be equal to minus 1 minus 2, which is minus 3. Minus 1 minus 2 is minus 3. If you consider this particular block, it will be equal to 3 plus 2, 5. So this is basically the adjoint of a matrix A. It was just a matter of 2 it was just a matter of 1 to 2 minutes. If you are fast with the calculations, it will hardly take you 1 minute. You can complete the answer in just 30 seconds. It's just a matter of 30 seconds. Okay, you don't need to apply the row operations or the column operations to find the inverse of a matrix, and this is only for the gate. Okay, if you are basically asked to find out the inverse of a matrix in the IES mains, you are not supposed to use this direct formula, this shortcut formula, because they will otherwise the examiners will not evaluate your answer, because they do not know the procedure of finding the A inverse. So this is only for gate and IES prelims. Okay, only for that. Now the second another property of the matrix is the adjoint of a matrix. Okay, adjoint of a matrix. So I think this term we have basically we came across this particular term in the last two lectures and in this lecture as well. So adjoint is nothing but adjoint of a matrix, nothing but the transpose of a cofactor matrix of the A matrix. Okay, so let A is equal to Aij n cross n be a square matrix, okay. The transpose B of the matrix B is equal to Aij n cross n, where Aij denotes the cofactor of element Aij is called as adjoint of the matrix A. Okay, and it is denoted by Adj of A. So we can say B is equal to Adj of A. So adjoint of A is nothing but cofactor of A transpose. That's just the transpose of that. Okay, and I basically described some properties related to the adjoint of a matrix A in the last lecture and also proved them. So I'm not going to write them here again. So please go through those formulas because they are very, very important. Also go through the proofs. Try to do it multiple times as you can until you embed those things in your, unless you embody those things in your brain so that you never forget. Okay. Okay. Let's have a look at this particular example. The matrix A, which is given to with this basically a 4x4 symmetric matrix, is a square matrix, has determinant of A is equal to 100 and trace A is 14. The value of mod of A minus B is what? Okay, so we know since trace of A is given to us as 14, and we know the trace is nothing but the sum of the principal diagonal elements. This will be equal to A plus 5 plus 2 plus b is equal to 14. So from here we get a plus b as 7. Okay, now we need to find out the determinant of a. So that determinant of a is given to us as 100, and from here we can say the determinant of a will be equal to 5 times of a 3 7 0 2 4 0 0 b. I'm basically opening the determinant along this, along the second row. Okay, and the determinant will only exist corresponding to the 5 value. Okay, because if we just take it with respect to 2, 1 and 3, this term will come out to be equal to 0. So the only term that we are left with is this. Okay, so this is basically 100. If you solve this, you get 5 into 2 into A into B, which is equal to 100. 10AB is equal to 100, and AB is equal to 10. Okay, so from the above two equations, we get A is equal to 5 and B is equal to 2, and A is equal to 2, B is equal to 5. So mod of A minus B will be equal to 2 minus 5 is equal to 3, or which is equal to 5 minus 2, we get 3. So 3 is the answer. Okay, the next property that we are going to discuss about the matrices is referred to as the rank of a matrix. I must say that this property is the most important property the questions on which can be frequently asked in the examinations. So you cannot even think of skipping this particular topic, because if you don't know this topic, you don't know linear algebra. That's what I can say. So the rank of a matrix is very, very important, and all the properties of a rank of a matrix must be embedded in your mind, in your brain. Okay, before starting off with the rank of a matrix, I am basically going to discuss something about the minors of a matrix. Okay, I'm going to some points on the minors of a matrix. Let me put the heading, the minors of a matrix. Okay, let's say the matrix A, let's say matrix A be a 4x5 matrix. Okay, let me just write it here. Let A matrix be a 4x5, let's say A1, B1, C1, D1, E1, A2, B2, C2, D2, E2, A3, B3, C3, D3, E3, and A4, B4, C4, D4, E4. Let's say this is a 4x5 matrix. If you are asked to find out the number of minors of order 4, order 3, order 2, and order 1, so how many minors of the same order will there be given any order matrix, any ordered matrix? For example, here we have a matrix A of order 4x5. So if you are asked to find out the number, how many minors can be taken out from this particular matrix which are of order 4. So minors will always be a square matrix. So minors are always a square matrix. So minors are square matrices. Minors are square matrices. Okay. So number of minors, if you are asked of number of minors of order 4, of order 4, will be equal to how many minors are there of order 4. So that can be basically found by using combination. So this will be equal to 5C4, then 5 is basically number of columns, into 4C4, which comes out to be equal to 5. Number of minors of order 3 will be equal to 5C3 into 4C3, and this will come out to be 4 into 10, which is 40. Okay, number of minors of order 2 will be equal to 5C2 into 4C2. This will be equal to 6 into 10, this will be equal to 60. Number of minors of order 1 will be 4C1 into 5C1, this comes out to be equal to 20. So this is how you are supposed to find out. The greatest minor, this is important, this is very, very important. The greatest minor is of order equal to minimum of number of rows and number of columns. So here we have if we consider this particular example, the greatest minor that can be made out of this particular matrix is of order 4. You cannot create a matrix, you cannot create a minor of order 5, though we have number of columns equal to 5, but the number of rows is less than 5, which is 4. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the greatest minor that can be made out of this particular matrix will have the order of minimum number of rows, comma, number of columns. Okay, so in general, if we just talk of a general matrix, for any matrix, I'm not basically generalizing it to a square matrix, for any matrix of order m cross n, this is m cross n, number of minors of order r will be equal to m c r into n c r. Okay, the order of the greatest minor, the order of a greatest minor is equal to the minimum of m comma n. This is very, very important. Okay, now let's dive deep into the main concept of matrices, which is the rank of a matrix. Okay, this property is very, very important, and it is highly recommended that you are well versed with the concepts that I'm going to teach you in a couple of minutes later. In the next couple of minutes. Okay, so let me just put the heading rank of a matrix. This is very, very important for any competitive exam. You are expected to know all the properties of a rank of a matrix. Okay, they can test your skill out at any point. So rank of a matrix is denoted by small r. So this property is applicable to any matrix. Applicable to any matrix. Either square or rectangle. It is applicable to any matrix of order A m cross n. You cannot generalize it to only square matrices. So it's applicable to any matrix, square or rectangular. So a rank is basically a number r is said to be the rank of the matrix A if and only if, first point, there exists a minor of order r which is non-singular or non-zero. Okay, all the minors of order greater than r are singular or zero. Is it clear or not? If there exists a minor of order r, then if there exists a minor of order r which is non-singular, whose determinant is not equal to zero or non-zero, all the minors of order greater than r are singular or zero. Okay, for example, if you just give you an example, for instance consider this particular matrix. Okay, 1 2 3 2 4 6 3 6 and 10. Okay, here you can see the determinant of A comes out to be equal to zero. Why is this so? Because if any row or column is basically a constant multiple of the first row or column or another row or column, then determinant of A will be equal to zero. Here you can see the second row is basically a constant multiple of the first row. So the second row is basically two times the first row. Hence the determinant of A will be equal to zero, which implies that, let me just write it here. If any two rows are constant multiple of each other, then determinant. Determinant is equal to 0. And rank will never be equal. Let's, for example, this is 3 cross 3 matrix. Rank of this matrix will not be equal to 3 and cannot be 3. So rank of A cannot be 3. So of course this is it's quite tacit from here, from the statements that I just wrote, that if the minor has the order equal to R, its determinant should not be equal to 0. It should be non-singular. But the determinant of A here in this case is coming out to be equal to 0. So from here we can conclude that rank of a matrix A is less than 3. Now let's basically move on to the second minor. If we consider this particular minor, let us consider the minor this 4 6 6 10. Determinant of this minor comes out to be 4 into 10 minus 36. It comes out to be equal to 4, which is not equal to 0. Hence we can say rank of a matrix A is equal to 2. So from here we can say the rank of a matrix A is equal to 2. Okay, if we apply the row operation, we shall discuss in the echelon form. So in order to find out, this was basically a very simple example. You may encounter very complex example of larger order matrices in the examination, and if you are asked to find out the rank of that particular matrix, it would be very, very difficult for you if you do not know how to reduce the matrix into its corresponding echelon form. Okay, so in order to find the rank of the matrix, it has to be reduced, we use elementary transformations. And I am hoping that you basically know how to perform the elementary transformation over the matrices, the row operation and the column operation. That's given in the 10th class NCERT book. If you do not know how to perform the elementary transformation, then I would basically advise you to go through the 10th class NCERT book, Determinant and Matrices chapter, and try to understand each and every concept there. Okay, then continue this particular video. Otherwise, there is no point in watching the video and not knowing anything. Okay, so by converting the given matrix into its echelon form, the number of non-zero rows, number of non-zero rows in the echelon form, in the echelon form of the matrix gives the rank of the matrix. Okay, so whenever a row in the echelon form reduces to zero completely, then it's quite obvious that the rank of that particular matrix is less than the order of the matrix. If single row becomes zero completely, then determinant of the matrix will also be equal to zero. If at least a row in the echelon form, if at least a row in the echelon form of the matrix reduces completely to zero, then determinant of the matrix, of the parent matrix, you can say, of the parent matrix is equal to 0. There should not be any second thought on that. Okay, that's basically a proved statement. And rank of the matrix is less than the highest order of the matrix. Okay, now let me basically describe what is basically an echelon form and how are you supposed to reduce the matrix into its corresponding echelon form. Okay, and what should be the structure of a row reduced echelon form. Okay, so echelon form of a matrix. So let me just write some rules so that it would be very, very helpful for you to reduce the matrix into its corresponding echelon form. So by applying the elementary transformation, we can convert a given matrix into a form in which all the zero rows must be present all the zero rows must be present below the non-zero rows. This is a must condition. Okay, the number of zeros before the first element, first non-zero number in each row, or you can say of a row, must be less than the number of zeros before the first non-zero number of the next row. Okay, such a form is called as an echelon form. This form is called as echelon form. Let me start off with an example and clear your concepts regarding that, so that it would be very, very it will basically give you a very crystal clear picture of how to reduce a matrix into an echelon form and how a echelon form of a matrix looks like. Okay, let me start with an example. Let us consider the matrix this -2, -1, -3, -1, 1, 2, 3, -1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, -1. You are asked to find out the rank of this particular matrix, but you cannot tell by just hit and trials. And you cannot directly find out the rank of this matrix by interpolation. For that, you have to reduce the matrix into its row reduced echelon form in order to save the time. Okay, now let's apply the row elementary row transformation. If we just do R2 2R2 plus R1 and R3 2R3 plus R1, then what do we get? It will be equal to minus 2, minus 1, minus 3, minus 1, 0, 3, 3, minus 3, we get 0, minus 1, minus 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, minus 1. It is not echelon form. It's not, this matrix is not satisfying the above two conditions which I just wrote. Okay. Now let's try to reduce, let's try to play with the third and the fourth rows. So in order for reducing the third row and the fourth row, we should not use, we should not use the first row, we should not use the first row, because if we use the first row, then this, the first elements of the third and the fourth row will become non-zero. So for that we will use the second row. Okay, now let's apply further operations. We can say R3 will be equal to 3, will be equal to 3 R3 plus R2, and let us apply R4, 3R4 minus R2. Let's see what do we get. This will reduce to, this will boil down to minus 2, minus 1, minus 3, minus 1, 0, 3, 3, minus 3. It will reduce to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Here you can see that the two rows have become 0 completely. Which this implies that number of non-zero rows in the echelon form is 2. So from here we can say the rank of this matrix is equal to 2, as there are only 2 non-zero rows. From here we can say the determinant of the matrix A will always be equal to 0. Okay, so if we, the minus of order 4 will have determinant equal to 0. Minus of order 3 have determinant equal to 0. Minus of order 2 have determinant not equal to 0. Okay, are these 3 points clear? It must be clear to you. Okay, let's have a look at another example. Let's have a look at this particular example. For what value of k rank of this matrix is equal to 2? Okay, so this implies that the if we consider the matrix, this is basically a 4 cross 4 matrix. If we consider the minor of order 4, the determinant of that will be equal to 0. But that would why should we make our calculations complex? So let's basically reduce the order of the minor to 3. Now we know that since rank of this matrix is equal to 2, the minor of order 3 will have the determinant equal to 0. So why don't we consider this particular minor whose determinant will be equal to 0, and which will help us to find out the value of k. Okay, so if we use this, or you can basically apply the row elementary transformations on that, and you can, and then you can reduce it to echelon form, and then you can find out the value of k. Okay, so let's use this. If you just see carefully, the determinant 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 2, 1, k, 0. Determinant of such will be equal to 0. Okay, so it will be equal to minus 1 of 0 minus 2 plus 1 into k minus 0 is equal to 0, which implies that k is equal to minus 2. Hence, the answer is minus 2. Or you can just basically reduce this thing to using the elementary transformation into the row reduced echelon form, and then you can easily find out the value of k that satisfy that satisfies the above two conditions which I basically described a couple of minutes ago. Okay, now let's draw our attention to the properties of a rank of a matrix, which are very, very important. They're utterly important. So the properties of the rank of a matrix, okay, properties of a rank of the of a rank of a matrix. Let write them down one by one. First, elementary root transformations do not affect the rank of a matrix. So elementary transformations do not affect rank of a matrix. Okay. Second point, only for the null matrix rank is equal to 0. Third point, if a m cross n is non-null matrix, then rank of a m cross n matrix will be less than or equal to minimum of m comma n and should be greater than or equal to 1. Okay, the maximum value of the rank of a matrix of any matrix m cross n of any matrix A whose order is m cross n will be equal to the minimum value of the number of rows and number of columns. Or you can say that's basically also the definition of a minor of a matrix. The maximum, the greatest minor has the order of minimum of number of rows and number of columns. Rank also has the same definition. Rank of a matrix m cross n attains the maximum value of minimum of m comma n, or number of rows and number of columns. Fourth, the rank of non-singular matrix of order n is n. Okay. Fifth, the rank of a singular matrix of order n is less than n. Okay, is less than n. Sixth, if all the minors of, let's say, of order R0, then rank of the matrix is less than R. Okay, if all the minors of order R0, then the rank of this matrix is less than R. As we just saw in this particular example, rank of this matrix is 2, then all the minors of order greater than 2 will be 0. Okay, so if this is 0, if all the minors of order R are 0, then rank of A is less than R. Okay. Now, seventh, rank of an identity matrix, rank of, let's say, I4, which is basically identity matrix of order 4 cross 4, is 4. Or in general, rank of an identity matrix IN of order N is equal to N. Eighth, rank of a diagonal matrix is equal to the number of non-zero elements in its principal diagonal. Okay, for example, if we have this 1 2 0 3 0 4, this everything is 0 because this is a diagonal matrix. So rank of this matrix, let's say A is equal to this, rank of this particular matrix will be equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, is 4. There are 4 non-zero elements in this diagonal. Okay? Ninth, the rank of a matrix represents the number of linearly independent row vectors or column vectors. As we can see, when we reduce the matrix into its echelon, into its corresponding echelon form, we are left with some non-zero rows and some zero rows. Zero rows basically correspond to those rows of the matrix A which were linearly dependent on each other, which were basically linearly dependent on some other row vector or column vector. The number of non-zero rows which are left at the end are basically totally linearly independent. Had they been linearly dependent, then one more row would have become zero completely, but that was not the case. Okay, if there are two non-zero rows left at the end, then those two rows are totally linearly independent. They do not depend on each other by some constant k. They're totally linearly independent. They cannot be reduced. The matrix cannot be reduced further. So the rank of a matrix represents the number of linearly independent row vectors or the column vectors. Okay. The tenth property, rank of A is equal to rank of A transpose. A transpose and A have the same rank. 11th, if A matrix of order m cross 1 and B matrix of order 1 cross n are two non-zero matrices, then rank A into B is 1. Always. Okay? For example, if we have the A matrix of order 3 cross 1, let's say 1, 2, 0, it's a matrix of order 3 cross 1, and B is a matrix of order 1 cross 4, let's say 2, 3, 4, 5. Of course, there should not be any order mismatch. So AB will turn out to be 2, 3, 4, 5, 4, 6, 8, 10, and 0, 0, 0, 0, which is a matrix of order 3 cross 4. Then rank of AB is equal to 2. So the rank of the matrix will be equal to 1. Why? Because the second row is linearly dependent on the first row by a factor of 2. So if we just multiply the first row with 2 and subtract from the second row, we get the second row as completely 0. So there is only one linearly independent vector, only one linearly independent row vector present. Okay? Now the 12th property. 12th property, if all the elements of A are a fixed constant K, if all the elements are basically of A are a fixed constant K and K is not equal to 0, then rank of the matrix A will be equal to 1. For example, we have this 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. All the rows have the same elements. So we can basically reduce the second and the third rows to 0 completely by using the first row. Hence the rank of this, so if you reduce it to echelon form, it will be 2, 2, 2, 2, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So from here we can say the rank of the matrix A is equal to 1. 13th property, rank of AB is less than equal to minimum of rank of A and rank of B. Okay, rank of AB is less than equal to minimum of rank of A and rank of B. For example, rank of A 4 cross 5 will be equal to 4, and rank of B 5 cross 7, let's say, is equal to 3. Then rank of A 4 cross 7, AB 4 cross 7 will be less than or equal to 3. Okay, the 14th property, rank of A plus B is less than equal to rank of A plus rank of B. 15th property, rank of A minus B should be greater than or equal to rank of A minus rank of B. And the 16th property is very, very important, the nullity of the matrix A. Nullity of matrix A. Let me just write the basic definition of the nullity of a matrix A. Nullity is defined as, so nullity represents the number of rows that have, represents the number of rows or columns that have become zero completely. Okay, nullity represents the number of rows or columns that have become zero completely. It represents the total number of zero rows or zero columns in the reduced echelon form of a matrix. In the echelon form of the matrix. Okay, so as we saw in this particular example, let's say in this particular example, nullity of the matrix A will be equal to 2, because there are two rows have become zero completely. But the rank of this matrix is equal to 1. Okay? If we are performing the row transformations, then we will consider the number of rows becoming 0. If we are performing the column transformations, then we shall consider the number of columns becoming 0 completely. Okay? Nullity of A is defined as minimum of number of rows, comma, number of rows and number of columns of A minus rank of the matrix A. This is very, very important. Defined as the minimum of number of rows, comma, number of columns of A minus rank of A. If determinant of A is not equal to 0, then we can say rank is equal to the minimum of m comma n. Then we can say rank will attain the maximum value. That's basically the maximum value of the rank will be equal to minimum of m comma n, and this implies that nullity of A will be equal to 0, because minimum of m comma n minus minimum of m comma n will be equal to 0. If determinant of A is equal to 0, is singular, then rank of this matrix will be less than minimum of m comma n, which implying that nullity of A is not equal to 0. Nullity also represents the number of linearly dependent rows or columns. Nullity also defines the number of rows or columns which are linearly dependent. Okay folks, I am stopping this lecture here, and we shall continue further in the next lecture. This lecture is very, very important. Try to understand each and every concept I explained in a very in great detail, okay, and try to be well versed with those. Thank you very much.